Hello and welcome to a tech tip video where we are going to learn how to create a spur gear inside SOLIDWORKS. We will be designing a spur gear in metric module. This video is inspired from an existing YouTube video created on the SOLIDWORKS YouTube channel. The video is being recorded from home and I apologize if there is any background noise. My name is Rahul Burkule and I'm working as an application engineer with Best Engineering Aids and Consultancies Private Limited. Now, let's see the SOLIDWORKS capabilities in gear design. I get asked a lot from my customers whether the spur gear model is going to be created automatically into SOLIDWORKS if the customer simply inputs the design data. The answer is no, except for those models that are readily available in the library. This does not actually work. We have to go with the traditional method of creating a sketch using global variables and equations to drive them dimensions, creating features from sketches, and automating the gear designs later on. Let's take an example here. When designing a spur gear, there are different design parameters to consider. Design parameters like the center to center distance, the gear ratio, the number of teeth, pitch circle diameter, module, etc., etc. The values to be considered when I am going to make a spur gear are number of teeth, 30 in number, the module that I am going to select is 3 mm. The important thing here is to note that the equations that I am going to use are as follows. The pitch diameter is equal to module times number of teeth. The outside diameter is going to be number of teeth plus 2 into the module. The root diameter as an equation for clearance has a multiplier saying that if the module is less than 1.25, the multiplier is 2.4. If the module is greater than or equal to 1.25, the multiplier is going to be 2.25, and hence the equation. The fillet will also be an intelligent one with an equation of 0.3 times the module. Now let's go to SOLIDWORKS and see how this can be used. So I am in SOLIDWORKS 2020. I go to File, New, go with the part. Whenever I open the part, the first thing I need to make sure is the system of units. I am in mmgs, millimeter gram second. You can choose whichever you want. To start the design of a spur gear, I would first like to tell you should go to equations. Now let's say if you can't find this equations tab in your feature manager design tree, where do you find it? Simply go to options, go to the feature manager, and under hide and show tree items, you can see equations. This should be put to show. Once you put it to show, say OK, and then the equations tab will appear there. Once the equation tab has appeared, right click that and say manage equations. This new tab that opens is where I am going to define my global variables. The first global variable that I am going to define is the module. Now you would observe that the global variables have to be defined within double inverted commas. In order to do that, I simply press tab and it takes the double inverted commas automatically. Then you have the column of value and equation where I can define an equation. Three things appear here: functions, file properties, or anything that I want to measure. I can link all of these over here. I can simply put a value here. Before that, I need to put equals to. When I put equals to, I say 3. The units can be defined from here, or if previously defined, 3 mm. Pressing on the green tick mark evaluates it to whatever has been defined there. You can also see that when I press the green tick mark or enter, another row appears which I can populate it to the number of teeth. Pressing tab again, you can see that value and equation appears. This time number of teeth, I'm going to put it as 30. The equal to sign has been taken automatically. It doesn't have any units. My two global variables are now defined. Press OK to come out of it. The next thing I would like to go for is start sketching. So selecting the front plane and going for the sketch. The first thing that I am going to draw is the pitch circle diameter. I have used some shortcut commands on my right click of the mouse, and I'm going to select the circle just by hovering over it. Start drawing the circle. I'm going to give it a dimension. It's not going to be a simple dimension. I can give an equation here linking it to the global variables. The important thing to note here is to click equals to first. You can see that global variables appear is simply module times number of teeth. The way you write the equation is also important. After module, give a space. This equation also takes in operators like multiplication, division, minus and plus. Module times global variable number of teeth, and the green checkbox evaluates the value and shows us the value to be 90 mm. Press OK. Another circle is going to be for the outside diameter, or as few might know it, addendum. The equation for this is going to be equals. Now I can use parentheses also, and in those parentheses I can simply start typing number of teeth, and you can see that it has appeared down simply by clicking this plus 2. No need for a space here. Times space the module. This equation is done. It has evaluated to 96 mm, which is correct. The third sketch that I am going to draw is of the root diameter or the addendum. Instead of giving it a simple equation, I am going to link it with a bit of a complex equation, dimensioning it through the outer circle. This becomes the clearance, and the value of the equation I'm going to specify here is the global variables module times. There's a new thing that I'm going to use here is the function if. Now those of you who already know what if function stands for, it goes with if the module that I'm going to specify is equal to or greater than 1.25, I want the multiplier value to come to 2.25. If it is not, the multiplier value would be 2.4. I simply press OK, and the value that comes is almost double that of the addendum, which is 6.75. As you can see, when I define equations to my sketches, you can see that the equations show a symbol in front of the dimension. Now that my sketching is done, I come out of my sketch. The next thing that I would do is to extrude this. Simply by pressing S on my keyboard for the shortcut menu, I have different commands that I can use. The boss extrude works in both the directions, as well as there are different options available over here. But what does this contour tool do? By default, it shows us the close contours that I can select and extrude. I want to extrude the outer circle. in both the directions to 20 mm. So simply right clicking mid plane, giving it a value of 20 mm. Now it is important to have the sketch in between, and just to have the design intent of the entire model that we are going to create. I'm going to set rotation about the scene floor, which rotates this. I'm going to go to my sketch and show the sketch. My next object would be to create the tooth profile or the cut in between the tooth. So I'll go to the front plane and start sketching on it. Since all the teeth are equidistant from one another, I'm going to start with a construction line. Draw a vertical construction line, and you know it is vertical because SOLIDWORKS shows you the different constraint in green. This time around I am going to define a 3-point arc which is going to represent the cut in between the two teeth. So going for the 3-point arc, I'm arbitrarily going to draw this 3-point arc on one side. Using the mirror command, selecting these two lines, and when I say mirror, it appears on the other side. Now if you would have observed, these two ends are free to move, and if I zap them onto the inner root diameter, they are constrained there. The next thing that I want to do is to select the outer edge and offset it by 1 mm. It is good practice to do this if you want to modify the sketches later on. The next tool that I would like to show you is the trim entities. So simply hovering it and by using its shortcut, the trim tool has been activated, and the power trim is an interesting tool to use here. Just observe what I'm doing. You can see that it has trimmed this. At the same time, I can select the inner circle and convert entities. Right? I need to trim that too. I'm going to trim it. And one unique capability that SOLIDWORKS gives you is that it gives you this red dot. If you go over it again, you can see that the line appears again. And if I want to trim it again, this is a very nice tool for saving a lot of design time. Okay, now that my sketch is ready, you can see that it is blue in color, and which tells me that it is underdefined. My next step over here would be to draw another construction line in between this. Just draw a construction line which is horizontal. This point is going to be important for us, and it has been created for the pressure angle. This point will always lie on this arc and the pitch diameter. So I'm going to select the point, the pitch diameter, and the 3-point arc, and you can see that I'm going to make an intersection there. Similarly with this point, a pitch circle and a 3-point arc intersection. And you can see our sketch is coming into definition. Now this arc needs to be tangent to the line which is going to be drawn from the center of the circle. So let's go ahead and do that. Again, I'm going to go with a construction line right up to this arc. Select the line and the arc and say that it is tangent. Now in order to define the pitch circle pressure angle, generic definition is that The pressure angle is the angle between the tooth face and the gear wheel tangent. In order to define that, again I am going to go with a construction line starting from the center line to towards the outer arc. This line and this point are always going to be coincident. Not only that, this line is always tangential to this arc. Once this is defined, we can go ahead and create the pressure angle as 20 degrees. Done. Now that the pressure angle has been defined to 20 degrees, the next thing is to take into consideration the number of teeth. Now the cut that we have done is going to be adjacent to the teeth that is going to be next to it. So in order to define the distance between the cut, the width of the cut is always going to be equal to the width of the tooth. That is what we have considered. So I can use this line starting from this point and draw it onto the pitch circle. This line is going to be defined as perpendicular to this, and this line is going to be equal to this line, so that the distance, center distances, are always going to be the same. After doing this, I am going to give an equation to this which defines it to be 180 degrees divided by the number of teeth. Okay. Now that my sketch is completely defined, it has turned into black, which is a good indication. Coming out of my sketch, I no longer need these sketches, so I'm going to go ahead and hide them. The only sketch that I need is of the cut in between the two teeth, and going with the cut extrude option, I can extrude this through all in both the directions and say okay. You can see that we have created one cut in between two teeth. The only thing we missed on is the fillet, which on purpose is going to be given later on. Our arbitrary number of 1 mm right now. I am also going to link this to the equation saying that the fillet should be 0.3 times the module, which evaluates to 0.9 mm, and I say okay. Now the only thing remaining here is to give a circular pattern of these features. So I'm going to select the features first, the cut and the fillet. The next thing is I need to give an axis around which it should be patterned. It could be done in multiple ways. The easiest way is to select the outside surface here, and the number of teeth. Again, adding intelligence here, we can add a global variable of number of teeth here, and it'll take the value automatically. And by doing this, my gear, spur gear, is almost ready. The advantage in doing this is that I can go ahead and right click on equations and say manage equations, and as I would point out, let me get the CAD model onto one side. If I change the value of the module from here, the model updates automatically. This is an advantage of creating global variables and equations. Now, as we had pointed out, if the module goes less than 1.2, The multiplier should also change. You can also use the spin button here to change the values. And just simply press enter and say OK. So this is one way of creating spur gear inside SOLIDWORKS. I hope you have liked the video. My next step would be to show you how we can make different configurations from the same gear design. I'm going to go back to my presentation. So when I say configurations, what are configurations? Configurations allow you to create multiple variations of a similar part or assembly model within a single document. So no need to save all of these components outside anywhere. You can save it within the same part or assembly. You can also automate the gear design using these configurations or design table, which is nothing but an Excel table in the background. This can also give you options to export the design table to an external Excel data sheet, which maintains a two-way link. So if you change the values in the external data sheet, the values update here and also the model updates. You can also upload standard gear data onto the Excel, and different configurations will be made here. So I'm going to go ahead and show you that. I'm going to minimize this, and I've worked on a spur gear design already, which I'm going to open and show it to you. So the way we start making configurations is to go to Insert, Tables, and go with this design table. Once you click on this design table, which is grid in my SOLIDWORKS because I've already made one, it'll ask you to auto create it. Just simply auto create it, and you will find it over here under Configurations tab, Tables, Design Table. I right click on this and I edit the table. The important thing to note here is Excel pops up in the background and it asks you, do you want to capture any parameters like the color, description, part number, etc., etc., or the dimensions that you want to drive through Excel. Just select all that you want to drive and say OK. What I have done here is, there is a trick behind this. How do you capture global variables into the design table? The way you do that is just observe the second column, how I have done that. I have captured the module here, and the way you need to write this is the dollar sign value at the rate, whatever the exact spelling and name of your global variable is, at the rate equations. And the same has been done for number of teeth and shaft diameter in this case. I've created one module, and if I need to create another module, all I need to do is create another configuration by the name of 2. This, let's say the value of, let's say, the module to be 2 mm, number of teeth 25, shaft diameter let's keep it to 10. I'm going to put another configuration that has module 3, number of teeth to be 30, and the shaft dia to be 15. Simply click outside, and in the background SOLIDWORKS is doing the work for you. The design table has generated the following configuration, and there is a message which has been displayed. Where do you find these configurations? Under the configuration table. So the first one that I'm going to show you is the configuration number 1. Simply double click on that and you will see what that configuration is. The shaft dia, the values that we had inputted here. The second configuration is the one that we made, and if I go to the equations and show you the equations, its number of teeth is 25, module 2, and shaft dia to be 10. The third one that we had generated is a slightly bigger one, with the equations being module 3, number of teeth 30, and shaft dia 15. This is the way you automate your designs. Now let me close this down, save this. I want to show you another method that is available within SOLIDWORKS, which is SOLIDWORKS libraries. SOLIDWORKS libraries is available with the SOLIDWORKS Professional and Premium, and you have standard gears available within the library. You can also create different versions of gears simply by inputting the design parameters, and they can be mated directly into the assembly. So I'm going to show you an example. This is where the library can be accessed from the toolbox, which has different standards. I'm going to go ahead with the ANSI metric standard. It has all of these components that are readily available. Under power transmission, you have gears. These are the different types of gears readily available. So simply drag and drop them and you can start populating them within the assembly. The example I'm going to take is of a helical gear. Right clicking on it, and I can say create part, or you can directly insert it into this assembly of the shaft, which is pre-made right now. I'm going to say create the part and show you how these gears can be made. So basically this gear has already been made and it opens up. You can configure this component and you get a drop down of the properties, asking you to fill up the properties. The module can be changed, the number of teeth again from 20 to whatever is there in this drop down. And do you want the helix direction to be left or right hand side? So all the details of the properties, helix angle, let's put this to 45 degrees, the pressure angle, the two which are available, 20 degrees, 14.5, the face width, so let's put this to 20 mm. The hub style, do you want a hub on one side or both the sides? So if I say one side, it just comes on one side. The hub diameter, how do you want the hub diameter to be? The overall length, etc., etc. Do you want a keyway? It'll insert a square keyway, it'll insert two square keyways if you say so. The file name that is going to be generated and can be populated within a bill of materials is going to be unique to the values that we just selected. You can see here, and you can also write a comment here. And when I say okay, so just remember that the nominal shaft diameter that we selected here was 10 mm. Right, so let me tile all of these windows vertically. I'm simply going to drag this part into the assembly, and as you can see, it has zapped onto the assembly and it has taken the mate automatically, which is a great thing for me. And I'll just show it to you around. So if I mate it exactly at the center of this shaft, giving it a width mate, now this will move only around itself. So these are the different ways in which we can create gears, mate them into the assembly, automate the gears, use the libraries. I hope this tutorial has been helpful for you. Stay tuned for more tutorials and videos like these. Like the videos, subscribe to our Beacon channel. We are going to upload all the videos there. Thank you, and feel free to write to us on support@beacon-india.com. Stay home, stay safe. Bye.